I actually got into the field of computer hacking at a very young age. My parents gifted me a computer when I was 10 years old, and the first couple of years I was just playing games. At the age of 12, I developed this interest in computer hacking. They always say, you know, what you're not allowed to do, or the forbidden fruit always attracts, and which is why I got interested in hacking. And I realized that in India, the awareness level for hacking was very low, which is why at the age of 14, I decided to write my first book, The Unofficial Guide to Ethical Hacking. And the response that we got was phenomenal. And within a few months, that book actually became a bestseller, not only in India, but globally. And that really encouraged me at the age of 14 to start converting my hobby of hacking into a full-time profession. And since then, if you fast forward many years since then, I have now written 19 books. In fact, this is my 20th book that we are launching today, which is my first fiction novel called The Casino Job. And I'll be briefly talking a bit more about this book. Now, along with publishing books, I have also started my own courses on ethical hacking. So over the last 10 years, more than around 25,000 people I have trained across India and globally as well. I also do training for police departments around the country, including right here in Telangana and of course earlier in Andhra Pradesh. I've also been, in 2008, I also started my own TV show on MTV India called What the Hack. So we did 3 seasons of that particular show as well. Of course, from books to training programs to courses, consulting is something that I also started. So I also advise companies and governments on how to actually improve their cybersecurity. More recently, when Sri Narendra Modi ji launched the Digital India Initiative, I was fortunate enough and lucky enough to be chosen as one of the brand ambassadors of the Digital India program. And my role was to actually promote digitization across all the public forums, all the seminars that I deliver and interact with the youth on. So that's my brief kind of background. I'm pleased to share that today I've actually written my first fiction novel. So although I've written 19 different books on technical topics, it's always been my dream to write a fiction novel. In fact, when I was at Stanford University as a student, I actually took up a course on fiction writing as well, which has been very helpful for me to write this particular book. Now, this book, of course, is also about hacking, where the main character in this book is a hacker who has a hobby, likes to hack into mobile phones, into websites, into their college website as well. And the story is about 3 friends that go to Goa on a holiday, and they decide to go to a casino ship to play some, to gamble some money and have some fun. And they were quite lucky and they won lakhs of rupees in that casino. However, the casino was actually run by the Israeli mafia, and they decided to actually drug them and leave them on the beach and steal all the money that they had won. So then the story is all about, I don't want to reveal the entire plot, but the story is all about how the 3 friends use technology, use the hacking skills to recover the money that was obviously theirs. So it's a thriller novel. In fact, this is India's first hacking-based thriller novel. There are obviously lots of love stories, romance novels that are out there. Even this novel has a little bit of romance in it, but this is India's first hacking thriller, super kind of fast-paced, and is aimed at all the technical youth of the country who love technology, who love hacking, and who have also been to Goa, which a lot of youth in India have been. Now, the idea of writing this particular book came to me when I was actually in Goa with my friends, and we happened to go to a casino, and I noticed that people don't even think twice before gambling away lakhs of hard-earned money. And wherever there is such a huge sum of money involved, there will be some crime, there will be some criminals who will become greedy, which is where the idea of this plot came to me. And this book has been published by Westland, which is a Tata company which was recently bought by Amazon, and is now available in all bookstores, both online and offline. Now, the timing of this book is quite interesting, because in the last few months there has been a lot of controversy in India about various topics. I'm sure all of you have heard about the Aadhaar challenge, where the chairman of TRAI released his Aadhaar details on social media and challenged hackers to hack into or misuse his Aadhaar details. So there is a lot of controversy about whether the hackers were successful in hacking into or misusing the Aadhaar or not. But I think it's important for the citizens of India to get the facts right. Number one, the main Aadhaar central database is secure. And this is a central database where all the private information, all the biometrics of all the citizens is stored. But the security risk comes in with all the different agencies or operators that are connecting to the Aadhaar to fetch the biometric details. For example, the mobile phone operators or the banks, etc., that are fetching the biometric details from the database. So I think that's where the security loophole sometimes comes in. So the government has already announced very strict kind of security policies and requirements to make sure that any operator that is not following the highest level of security required will not be allowed to connect to the Aadhaar network. But what can citizens do? First of all, do not make the mistake of sharing your Aadhaar details on public social media platforms or with people that you don't trust, which is pretty obvious. But surprisingly, if you do a quick Google search, you'll be surprised how many different Aadhaar cards are available online. People are not thinking about, you know, their own privacy and security and blindly sharing the Aadhaar details. Secondly, the government has actually launched something known as a virtual Aadhaar ID. So instead of sharing your actual Aadhaar number with your cell phone provider or your bank or any other company, you can log on to the UIDAI website and you can actually create a virtual ID of your Aadhaar, which will be valid for 24 hours, and it's safe to actually share that with anybody that you want. So always do that. Secondly, you can on the UIDAI website, you can actually lock your biometric details. So if you're worried that somebody is going to misuse your Aadhaar, you can block your biometric details so that they are safe and secured and encrypted and cannot be stolen. Finally, you can also log on to the UIDAI website and you can actually see a history of all transactions and authentications that have taken place related to your Aadhaar card. So I think that's these are some basic security measures or tips that citizens can actually benefit from. The second big kind of controversy in the last few months, which will actually become even bigger in the next few months, is the influence of fake news on the political, the economic and social kind of activities in the country. I'm sure you've read about the mob lynchings that happened across different cities in India. Donald Trump's election was actually marred with a lot of fake news and the important role that fake news played in it. So going forward, in the next year elections as well, social media will play a very, very important role. And when I say social media, I mean Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and even WhatsApp. So any of these mediums where people are spending every single day hours together will actually be used by various political parties to influence the results of the elections. So it's very important for citizens to be aware that fake news is just a part of life now, and you can actually implement some basic kind of solutions to protect yourself against fake news. For example, in your browser, you can install a simple app called BS Detector. BS Detector, it's available as a free download. What it does is, whenever you're visiting a website or reading an article, this app will tell you whether it is fake news. And the way it works is it's crowdsourced, and it also looks for certain patterns or certain websites that are known to host fake news. So it can alert unsuspecting citizens that please do not believe this piece of news because this happens to be fake. Similarly, there's another one called Project Fib, F-I-B. So Project Fib is an app, free app that you can install in your browser. And whenever you're on Facebook or any other social media networks, if there is an article that happens to be fake, or if there is a link that points to a fake article, you will be alerted, you will be informed that please do not believe so and so article. The last thing that people need to do is, instead of blindly believing a particular article that they're reading, do two simple tests. Number one, double check the URL. Because a lot of times what people do is, instead of, say, I'm just giving an example, newyorktimes.com, nytimes.com, it could be nyetimes.com. So just by changing the spelling a bit, a little bit, a lot of citizens will not even realize that they're on a fake website, but will actually believe that, hey, New York Times has published this article, and they'll blindly believe the body of that article. So do that simple check. Secondly, it's always good to actually go to the real website and then try to search for the article. Because if it's a fake article, while they can fool you by changing the URL a little bit, but if you actually go to the real website and try to source that article, that's a big test of checking whether it's a fake or a real article. The last big trend which I wanted to talk about today is the kind of increase in mobile phone hacking. All of us are nowadays using, you know, smartphones, and on our phones you have very private information. For example, you have all your WhatsApp messages, both professional messages and personal life messages. You have sensitive photographs. You obviously have emails. And through your SMS, you also have the OTP that your bank sends you whenever you're doing some kind of net transaction or online credit card transaction. Nowadays, it's actually extremely easy for hackers to hack into your mobile phone. And there are two or three simple ways that they actually use. Number one, if somebody manages to gain physical access to your phone, it will take maybe 2 or 3 minutes at the most for that person to install something on your phone. And the best part is, when they install something on your phone, it is completely hidden. So if you scroll left or right on your phone, there will be no new icon that will be visible anywhere. So imagine that you and I are colleagues, we work in the same organization, but I want to actually hack into your phone and spy on your messages. So all I'll do is I'll pretend that I have run out of battery and borrow your phone. And most people don't think twice before giving their phones to their friends or colleagues. But once you give your phone to me, that's going to be the biggest mistake of your life. Because I'm going to quickly open your browser, install the spying software on your phone, and return it back to you within 2 minutes. And you have no idea what has happened. And now, once you go home, I will actually log on to the website of that spying software, and I can see everything that's happening on your phone. I can read your WhatsApp messages. I can see who you're calling. I can get your OTP numbers that your bank or credit card company is sending you. I can see which websites you're browsing. And I can also see your live location at any given point of time. In fact, a lot of people are emailing me these days saying that, I think my spouse or girlfriend or boyfriend is cheating on me. Can you please help me hack into their phones? Because by using these mobile phone hacking tools, you can actually find out who your spouse or girlfriend or boyfriend is chatting with. You can find out where they are going. So if they are telling you that, hey, I'm in office, you can actually check their exact location. Of course, there is a positive side to this as well. A lot of parents are actually using this app to monitor their kids. Because nowadays, you have no idea what your kids are doing online, who they are chatting with, which websites they are visiting. So this app is a good kind of parent monitoring app as well. So of course, like any hacking software, there is a positive side and there is a negative side as well. But if you apply the same app in the corporate world, a lot of companies, CEOs are using this to spy upon their competitors. And what they do is, say during Diwali, you will receive a brand new gift, which is the latest iPhone or the latest Samsung phone. But what you don't know is that that phone has been pre-installed with a spying software. So you may think that, oh, this is such a great client. They gave me the best handset, which was costing 60, 70,000 rupees. But actually, it already has a spyware installed in it and can actually be, and is transmitting data back to the criminals who can then spy upon everything that you're doing. So that's basically a brief overview of the different trends that are taking place in hacking, and a brief overview of my book as well.